Hello, I'm Chris Lisher, and welcome to Turning of the Wheel, an intelligent, lively discussion about astrology, art, and spiritual adventure. Timing is everything, and as the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed. Join me as I explore concepts that allow us to broaden our view of the world. You'll hear interesting topics, meet fascinating guests, and discover who you really are. Using the time-tested practices of astrology, you'll learn how to accept change as the great wheel of life turns. Astrology, art, and spiritual adventure on Turning of the Wheel TV with Chris Fleischer. Hello, and welcome to Turning of the Wheel. My name is Chris Fleischer, and this is a show about astrology, art, and spiritual adventure. And today we're going to talk about astrology, primarily, and we're going to talk about the most predominant character in the astrological zodiacal wheel, the sun. The sun is the major portion of the astrological whole layout, and it's the most important thing. It's the one thing that most people can recognize within the world. Even those of us who are not well-versed in astrology will always point to what's called sun sign astrology. Sun sign astrology is the astrology that's based on the time of the year that you are born, and that's why it's associated with the sun. 97% of the people in the world know their astrological sign. They know what their sign is. What they don't know is what goes beyond that. One of the fascinating things about astrology is that knowing the sun sign does give you a clue into the indication of the character of the individual, but doesn't give you the full picture. That's what these educational segments are all about. When you know more information, because we all have an array of planets in our charts. When we are born at that moment in time, we each have a Mercury, we each have a Venus, a Jupiter, a Saturn. All of the planets in our zodiacal wheel, out to the planet Pluto, are somewhere in what's called a horoscope chart. In that chart, we all have a piece of those characteristics, and each of us are a composite of a multitude of signs. But for today, what I'm talking about is our role of the sun sign. What does the sun say about you as an individual, and how does it manifest itself throughout the wheel of the zodiac? And why do certain signs get along better than others? Well, that's a very good question. First of all, we know that the sun is sort of the master of our local solar system. It's the primary heat source. It's what gives us the power, hopefully, in the future. And it provides us with the light and the changing of the seasons. And our Earth, the planet that we're riding on, it goes around the sun 365 days it takes to go around the whole wheel. And that whole thing is not a small figure. 360 degrees is the same degrees in a circle. So we're going around that thing in that same sort of mathematical pattern, which is fascinating when you think about our role as members of the planet going through that process. So we have these 12 different signs, each of which comprise about 30 days, or the equivalent of a month. And in that period of time, we have an enormous amount of information. The planets start out, and they alternate between pluses and minuses. The minuses does not mean it's a bad planet. It's just a way of expressing polarity. Everything, we are a polarized entity, so to speak. Everything we do in our life is based on sort of what is called the duality of life. We have pluses, we have minuses, we have males, we have females, we have dark, we have light, we have good, we have bad. The list goes on forever of all the polarities. We have two eyes, two arms. This is why we think of our brain is divided in half, left and right. So we have this dualistic approach to life. There is no weight attached to the polarities. It's not to say that a plus sign is better than a negative sign. It's just that that's there for the sake of reference. And it's more of a demarcation in many ways, just to say that we're here at one place going on to the next. So we work our way through that as we go around the zodiac wheel. And it's very important to understand that. It's just a simple thing. Primarily, one of the main important reasons about the polarity is that it allows you to know other signs with which you're most likely to be associated, or which you do better with. Now, we know that each of the signs is associated with an element. Each of the sun signs is associated with an element. So let's go through the sun signs, and so we know what we are and what element we're attached to. So first of all, they're attached to an element as well as what's called a modality. And the modality is what's called sort of the character of that sign. I've gone into this in the past a little bit on some of my other segments, and we'll talk about that as well. There are four elements. There's fire, air, earth, and water, or fire, earth, air, and water, I should say. And then we have three modalities. We've got cardinal, we've got fixed, and we've got mutable. Okay? So if we start out with Aries starts out in the spring, that is a cardinal fire sign. It's cardinal fire because it's the initiation planet of the first sign of the thing is the initiation. It's Aries. Next, we have Taurus, which is fixed Earth. Then we have Gemini, which is mutable air. Then we have Cancer, which is water, cardinal water. After that, we have Leo, which is fixed fire. Then we have Virgo, which is mutable earth. Then we have Libra, which is cardinal air. Then we have Scorpio, which is fixed water. Then we have Sagittarius, which is mutable fire. And then we have Capricorn, which is cardinal earth. And then we have, after that, we have Aquarius, which is fixed air. And finally, we have mutable water, which is Pisces. Now, each of those 12 signs have distinct characteristics. They start out with Aries, which is positive. We go into Taurus, which is comes in as a negative, not to be weighted with any sort of attribute or judgment calls, just a, for the sake of organization, we'll call it that. We move on to Gemini, which is again a plus, and then we go into Cancer, which is again a negative. That polarity works itself all the way around the wheel till we get to Pisces, which is a negative, leading itself into Aries, which is the positive. So when we think about Aries, there's some of the great characteristics of Aries, and those of you who know who you are know very well, Aries are very much of the people who start it. Since they're the very first sign of the zodiac, they start the zodiac. They're represented by the ram. They're the ones that go out and go blazing through the jungle. They're known for their courage. They're known for their impulsivity. They're known for their action. They're known for many, many characteristics which come into the realm of Aries. And it's a very vital sign to have. It's those, we find great leaders in Aries. We'll find people who are the trailblazers. And it's represented by the ram, because the ram is what goes charging into the forest headstrong. Oftentimes, Aries can be quite impulsive and very headstrong. They have got wonderful characteristics as well. They're lively, they're cheerful, they're loyal, they're rambunctious, they're impulsive, they're generous. They've got a great many qualities. As a matter of fact, all the signs have attributes and liabilities. They both have this balance. Again, we come back to that word of balance, where we have this quality of what is going on there. So the sun is representative of, and if your sun is in Aries, then you are in Aries at your core. This is your foundational characteristic. The next sign we move on to is Taurus. As I mentioned earlier, Taurus is a fixed Earth sign. So it comes right after into the April and May of the zodiac calendar, which is a time in northeast half of the world, at least, of springtime and this sort of rising of the earth, and we get that great, fertile earth sign. But and the Tauruses are known for their steadfastness, their love of food, and all things having to do with sort of the material qualities of life, food and drink and fine clothing and all those wonderful things. It's kind of funny that they really love luxury. You know, we think of Taurus, if we had to summarize them, we'd say, food, sex, and money. Those are the things that they want the most. It's very funny when you think of it that time. And those of you who are Tauruses obviously will recognize that. It's a very strong quality. Very steadfast, slow, methodical, but sometimes very stubborn. This is one of the things we have to look at, and this is important to understand. But again, if you're a Taurus, this is your foundational characteristic of who you are. Next, we move on to Gemini. Gemini is a mutable air sign. Mutable means it's adaptable. It has, it's much more loose. It's not as rigid in its construct. And immutable signs tend to be those that are more adaptive and adaptable. And Gemini is ruled by Mercury, so it has that great sense of communication. Geminis are those who love to communicate. You find people in broadcasting, you find people as writers, you find actors, you find musicians. Some of the world's greatest musicians are Geminis. The first people that come to mind are Bob Dylan and Paul McCartney, both strong Geminis. And they have that characteristic of being able to communicate. But there's also, on the negative side, and that's a positive sign, they have this sort of ability to communicate, but they're sometimes a little bit superficial. That somehow is one of the cases that comes across. But that's not a negative. As I said, all signs have negative and positive characteristics to it. Oftentimes, you'll find Geminis teaching classes. They're the ones that are they're great in the classroom, hosting a group of kids. They're the ones that make great presenters. You'll find a lot of them in movies and acting. It's the sign of communication. It's a very strong sign. And it's an air sign. Okay, so an air sign is going to get along with a fire sign, just the way a earth sign is going to get along with a water sign, which brings us to the next sign, which is Cancer. Cancer is a wonderful sign. It brings out, it's a very much of a warm, nurturing, sort of motherly quality, and it's ruled by the moon. So the mother is the great moon. It's the great maternal quality. It's the great sort of watery realm that imbues the people who have that sign with a sense of magnanimity and a sense of generosity and warmth and nurturing. They're very sensitive by the same token. So you find artists sometimes with a strong Cancer component in their charts, especially if that's their foundational sign. It's important to know these foundational signs because this is really who your character is, especially when it comes to, you know, choosing jobs, finding partners. You want to be sure you're with somebody who is compatible with you in that regard. And I'll get into that more as we move on. But it's very important to understand the characteristics of the individual signs. And we all love our signs, and we all know our signs, so it's very important for that. The next sign we come to is Leo. Leo is the big, bold, bright, sunny character that is known for its creativity. It's ruled by the sun, the native sun. As I mentioned, we were talking about the sun signs today. So this is the premier creator represented by Leo. Leo is the lion. He's the big, proud person that walks into the room, who sort of fills up the room. You can always tell when you're in a room with a Leo. They are incredibly loud. They have a sense of presence and charisma that sort of overwhelms wherever they are. If a Leo walks into the room, you can almost feel it. A perfect example would be someone like a Bill Clinton, for example, who walks in the room, everybody knows he's there. He makes sure that's the case as well. So it's pretty funny to see these characteristics. Of course, Leo is a fixed sign. It's a fixed fire sign. So yes, it's a fire sign, so it gets along with the other fire signs in the chart, Aries and Sagittarius, but it still is a fixed sign, so it's more rigid in its implementation of that. So even though it's a leader, even though they're highly creative people, they're more rigid in their approach. They're less likely to be flexible. So they are a fixed sign in that regard. The next sign we come to is Virgo. Now, Virgo is a wonderful sign. We find Virgo to be the servant. The Virgo is represented by the servant. It's sort of the virgin. It's also another name for it. And it represents the quality of people to give. This is a very giving sign. They're the ones that you see as your dental assistants. They're the one you see in the doctor's offices as nurses. You find a lot of doctors and nurses there because they are very detail-oriented. They have a sense of precision. They understand certain mechanical qualities of what it takes to make life work. They're the real doers, but they're a mutable sign, so they're adaptable, which means that they are very good in serving others. Now, when I say serving, I don't mean that they're a waiter or a waitress, but they are those people who help. Ministers, of course, ministers, you find a lot of them are Pisces. We'll get to that as we get down. But we think of them as people as lawyers, accountants, people who serve, who are able to wrap their heads around a lot of details. Details are very important. But on the negative side, Virgo can be very judgmental. They can be very picky and very sort of obsessed about their current area. They're very obsessed with cleanliness and sort of a sense of order. They like order in certain areas of their lives. But, you know, people are different. Oftentimes you'll find a Virgo very organized in one area of his life and yet completely scattered in another. But there is these tendencies that we'll find. And again, being an earth sign, obviously it's an earth sign, so it's going to get along with other earth signs, Taurus and Capricorn. The next sign we come to is Libra. And many people refer to Libra as Libra. I prefer Libra because it's how I learned it. It's always the way it's been. But I have heard the term Libra, but I prefer the word Libra. Libra is the only sign in the astrological toolbox that uses the balance of the scales as their symbol. And it's sort of that representativeness of finding equanimity within all things, okay? It's a cardinal air sign. So cardinal air means that they are the kinds of people who like to start things, but they're very intellectually driven. A lot of their activity is cerebral, and it has to do with their ability to think and be able to put things together, that sort of visual quality of aesthetics. We find a lot of Libras in the world of aesthetics, such as in the beauty salons and the arts especially. We find a lot of, especially in the visual arts, we'll see a lot of people with a very strong Libra component. It just makes sense. They enjoy that. That's a very stimulating piece for them. One of the problems with Libra is that they, because they do see both sides of the scale so clearly, they oftentimes don't know which way to go. They may go to bed knowing the answer and wake up in the morning and feel just the opposite. So in that regard, they sort of make good judges in some cases because they can see, or lawyers, because they can see both sides of the story very clearly. There's that real duality that is very prevalent in their character. And it's important to understand that. After Libra, we move into Scorpio. Now, many people think of Scorpio. Scorpio is a fixed water sign. Meaning that fixed, again, means that they have a certain tendency to be rigid and inflexible with their decision-making. Now, Scorpios are a fascinating sign. Many people always say, oh, Scorpio, wow. Scorpios have an ability to be intense people, but they're also very secretive in some ways, but incredibly loyal. They're incredibly loyal, dedicated, hardworking people who like to operate behind the scenes oftentimes. They're the ones that are back there pulling the strings in the wheels of government, for example. Are they very good researchers? Are they very good lawyers, sort of doing the research beneath the surface? They're always associated with sex and death, but that's not always fair. Many signs have an affinity for both of those things, so we can't necessarily pin it all on Scorpio. But it is an accurate depiction of sort of that character of the secrecy. There's a sense of intrigue, a sense of deep mystery that's there. But again, Scorpios are a fixed sign. So they, even though they are very loyal and rigid, once you cross one, forget it. You're never going to get back in there. There is a sense of that rigidity that, you know, once their minds are made up, they are not moving. And that's very true of the case. Now, being a water sign, they're going to get along with the other two water signs, Cancer and Pisces. So they're very much a lot of synergy there with that water. They have a sense of nurture, though, because that water is what gives them depth. Still waters run deep, as they say. The next sign we come to is Sagittarius. Sagittarius is the great archer. The Sagittarians are, it's a mutable fire sign, but in the result of that, they tend to be the ones who love to wander. They're the great travelers. They're the great spiritual seekers. They're the ones that our recent Pope Francis, for example, is a Sagittarius as a sort of a personality touchstone. They're the ones that have these lofty visuals, lofty ideas. They love to travel. They love to be out in the world and exploring. They're the great wanderers. It's ruled by, they have this Jupiter is the ruler, and Jupiter is this big magnanimous sort of wanderer. And they have this great characteristic about being able to wander and sort of take on enter into a global stage, and they love topics of spirituality and education are strong characteristics for them as well. As a result, though, as I said, all signs have pluses and minuses. Sometimes they can be a little flaky and not always true. Sometimes they tend to wander too much, especially if they're a salesman, for example. A traveling salesman would be a perfect person who represented the Sagittarius, always on the road, traveling. Yes, but what's happening back home is that he's missing the growth of his children, for example. So that's a very good example of what a Sagittarius might look like. It's a fire sign, and it's a mutable sign. So it's going to fit up with the other two fire signs. It's going to do well with Leo. It's going to do well with Aries. The next sign we come to is Capricorn. Capricorn is a cardinal earth sign. And cardinal earth means that they are the ones who do the building. Capricorns are known for being the best and most productive workers in the whole zodiac realm. You want to hire somebody with a good Capricorn quality, or a Capricorn for that matter. They're very diligent. They're very determined. They're very stoic. They have a sense of reservation to them that is sort of proud and meaningful. And they're the ones that can sort of rule basic fundamental foundational characteristics of an organization. You might find strong university presidents with a Capricorn, or people who are in high offices like that who have a lot of responsibility. They're ruled by the planet Saturn, so there's that sense of responsibility there, that just that doing the right thing is really what they want. They want to have the ability to do the right thing. But as an earth sign, they are foundational, they're cardinal, which means they are the ones that start things. Remember, cardinality is about starting something. So they're the ones that start things, but they start in the earth. They're the great builders. They're the great architects. They're the ones that like to work with organizations and build things up from the bottom. As I said, they're very stoic. They're very hardworking. And the opposite side of that, sort of the downside of them, is that sometimes they're a little bit difficult to penetrate. They have a sense of detachment to them sometimes, and they're not always, and sometimes they work too hard, so you might not see them if you're married to one. They may be in the office all the time, working. But they're very goal-oriented, very success-driven, and they tend to have a very strong work ethic. It's one of the greatest things about them. And again, they are an earth sign, so they match in very well with the Tauruses and the Virgos. It's very clear there. The next sign we come to is Aquarius. Aquarius is a fixed air sign. So fixed, again, means that they are sort of impermanent. They are permanent. They don't tend to move with their opinions, and they're very rigid and strict in that regard. But they have a wonderful character of being able to sort of take care of the world. Their view is very much of a global humanitarian view. They are very they're non-self-centered. In other words, they're not that focused inwardly. They're much more focused outwardly. So a lot of their views and ideas and motives have to do with the greater good. We see people who will work in large organizations such as universities or hospitals. These are the people who are able to express their personalities outwardly. They have this great sense of this outward quality to them that helps them do things in ways that others can't. And as a result of that, they have this strong sense of social responsibility would be the best way to think of them. Socially responsible people are just that. They take their responsibilities very seriously. Now, when we think of Aquarius, we think of people less such as Abraham Lincoln, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, two of the most well-known Aquarians in the United States history. Both of them spent all of their time and energy trying to resolve major global problems. And they were very successful at that. That's what made them go down in history. Aquariuses are very much the case. That is very much what they do. As I said, their negative side, though, sometimes is that they're a little bit aloof. Both Abraham Lincoln and Franklin Delano Roosevelt did not have very successful, close, intimate relationships because their mind was too preoccupied with their sort of their greater goal. Their whole modus operandi, their whole motive is to be motivated towards helping others. And so sometimes they tend to let the home fires dwindle. As a result, we don't see a lot of warmth there. Sometimes there's a certain detachment, a little bit of an aloofness, a little bit of a chilliness there. And this is not a criticism. All these signs have negatives and positives. These are just random, non-judgmental observations of the individual signs. They're very important to understand what the signs are all about. Aquarius is an air sign. People often get it confused because it sounds like aquarium, but it's Aquarius. It's an air sign. It's a fixed air sign. So Geminis and Libras and Aquariuses are the three air signs. They tend to get along quite well. The last sign in the zodiac is Pisces. Now Pisces is the very last sign, and there's some theories about Pisces that say that they are the culmination of all the signs to the very end. That may be true in some cases. They are known for their wisdom. They are known for their depth. They're known for their spirituality. As I mentioned earlier, oftentimes we'll see spiritual people with a strong Pisces quality, or people who are very religiously bound have a strong Pisces quality. But there's also this very lofty dreamlike quality. They're ruled by the planet Neptune, so there's this sort of this amorphous, lost spaciness, daydreaming kind of quality to them. But as a result of that, they're able to sort of tap into that very sensual area where we find, you know, the escapism and the sort of the array of what theater might look like, theater and the dramatic arts. And of course, that same sort of theater and that element of theater does come into the world when you think about someone who is a religious leader. A religious leader has to be able to express themselves. They've got to have some certain element of charisma in order to be able to express themselves to the public and into the world. So they have that quality. On the negative side for Pisces, we see them sometimes as being forgetful, a little spacey, as I mentioned. You know, they're the kind of people who will say, oh my gosh, I was supposed to meet you for lunch and I never showed up, or things like that. They've always got some excuse, or they've gotten sidetracked in many ways. Often meandering, wandering around, lost in a daydream. You could be talking to a Pisces sometimes and you don't even know if they're listening. This is, again, not a criticism, just an observation. Pisces is a mutable water sign. Mutable water means that it's fluid and mutable. It means it's adaptive just the way water is. And it's also in line with the Cancer and the Scorpio, because those are the three water signs. So typically we'll find people with signs who have the same element will get along with the same person. Now that would be true for Aries, Leo, and Sagittarius. Those are the three fire signs. They get along very well. Taurus, Virgo, and Capricorn, they tend to get along well because they have that strong earthbound quality to them. Gemini, Libra, and Aquarius all have the same sort of cerebral, intellectual characteristics that they enjoy and that bind them together. They understand that a lot of what happens with them happens in the conversation. It's all about the cerebral quality. And then finally, the three water signs, Cancer, Scorpio, and Pisces. They have that depth, that richness, that sense of, you know, that quality, that universal quality of nurturing, and some, as in the case of the Cancer. So now what we find is that everybody has characteristics of each of these signs. We all know our signs. Everybody knows their signs practically. As I mentioned earlier, it's a high percentage of people in the world that know their astrology signs. When people know their astrology signs, it helps them determine where they're going, what they're doing, who they're going to be engaged with, and how successful they will be. You'll often find people say, I do this all the time with my clients when they contact me, I'll know immediately more about them as a result. Obviously, the sun sign is just the superficial layer of astrology. I wanted to touch a base on it here so that you understood what it was all about. But it really is just the basis. It's based on the sun. And the sun, as you know, is the giant orb that rules our neck of the woods, our solar system, and it gives us the light that keeps us afloat and provides our, you know, the photosynthesis for the plants and the evaporation of the water, all of those characteristics. But metaphorically, astrologically, it's a very important role. It's sort of the heart of the individual. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we are a composite of all the signs in the chart, because each of us has a sun sign, which dictates our major character and our major character attributes. But we also have each of the other planets are in other parts of our chart, so those all have a certain weight as well. The weight of those other signs are part of what makes up the individual. And that's where we get the uniqueness of an individual as well. We'll see that across the board. It's important to remember that astrology, in this capacity, this is part of the reason astrology doesn't get a very good recognition, and sometimes as people say, it's impossible for all people who have one sign to have a good day. When you read the horoscopes in the newspapers or wherever, that is part of the problem. Yes, that is a major part of the problem. Not everybody who's an Aquarius is going to go out and work in a hospital, for example, or not everybody who's a Virgo is going to be a dentist or a doctor. That's not always the case. The most important part of it is that you understand these basic elements. These are the basic core principles that are the underlying piece of you. It's kind of like the foundation of a house. The foundation of a house is what is at the core. It's what holds the house together. But we know that there's several layers of bricks or wood or mortar or beams that go above that, and again, the roof as well. All of those are elements. That's what the astrology chart is very much like. Your sun sign is your core foundational character. And then as you work your way up through that building, you take on new attributes, which gives you that composite sense of who you are. It's an incredible portion of who you are. When you're looking to date somebody or you want to know who to be with, it's important to find someone who has similar characteristics. Oftentimes, the elements work the best, fire to fire or fire to air, as I mentioned, water to water or water to earth, earth to water, air to fire. All those are incredibly important and valuable pieces of what it makes to make people work. But as I said, one of the things about the sun signs is that it's very narrow. You need to have more data. You need to know the moon. You need to know the rising sign in order to get a much better placement of that. Oftentimes, you'll get along very well with a person, and you'll do it immediately. But do you want to spend the rest of your life with them? That's where the complexity comes into. Astrology really is the very original psychology. It's the earliest form of psychology. And when you understand it, you can make great advances in your career and your relationships. You can make healthy choices based on the timing and based on your own ability to understand life, your characteristics, how best to live to them. You learn your attributes and you learn your liabilities. When you play up your attributes and work on your liabilities, you become a composite whole human being. And I will talk to you all next week. Take care.